construction methodologies, and mainly I'll be focusing on precast technology in high-rise residential buildings. I'll be showing a lot of slides to you so that you will picturize what exactly is the precast technology which will be adopted in the high-rise constructions. Dear students, my subject is different types of construction methodologies including precast technology as one of the option and construction process in high-rise residential and commercial building. Presenter is I am Nagesh Patel. I'm a senior project manager in Kepil Purvankara. I'm a postgraduate in a structural engineer where I passed out my engineering as well as post-graduation from Siddhartha Institute of Technology, Tumkur. I have more than 25 years experience in the construction field. I have handled more than 6 to 8 million square feet of construction, high-rise residential buildings. You know, 1 million is 10 lakh square feet. In terms of volume of the whichever I've handed over the residential unit in numbers, one of the biggest project I was a construction head from my Kepil Purvankara Development Private Limited, where I've handed over 1,600 apartment units, where it is in JP Nagar, Bangalore. I'll be showing the slides on that. And one of the another 2,068 units we are constructing a park square called in Kanakapura Road. It is in Kanakapura Road, Telagatpura. It's a park square of 2,068 units where we have used the precast technology for the wall, for the staircase, for the slabs, for the beams. I'll show you on the slides. And please observe, if you have any queries on that particular slide, you can question me, you can ask me, I'll try to clarify those things. Okay, we'll start with the presentation on that. Different types of construction methodologies including precast technology. So let us start with what is the different types of construction methodologies. So normally you go with this brick wall construction and mud shattering the old previous days. Nowadays I think even in the villages we practice that mud shattering technology where for the shattering you don't use the plywoods or the aluminium formwork. Where you are using the mud shattering. And the next process will be after you do this when the core shell is ready of with the brick wall and the mud shattering, if the slab is ready, you will start with the solid block wall construction along with the sheet shattering. I said the mud shattering was the old primitive one, and the sheet shattering will be the recent one. And you have column, beam, slab, block wall construction for high-rise residential and commercial building, and shear wall constructions. I will also be showing you on that what is a shear wall concept, where you don't have block wall, everything will be the concrete wall. The wall will be the concrete one. You are all civil engineers, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. The shear wall construction using Maiwan shattering. The Maiwan is from Malaysia, where you can. The entire is a cage type where the reinforcement cage will be there. When you pour, when you de-shatter it, the wall will be ready, the concrete wall will be ready. And coming to the topic of today is the precast wall technology as well as precast slabs also. And the sequencing, what are the sequencing involved in a high-rise residential building and commercial building or a low-rise building? I'll be telling you what is a low-rise building and a high-rise building. So the process involved for the construction of residential to commercial building, first to start with any project of residential or commercial building, you'll be going with an earthwork, which will be a mass excavation. If you have a deep basements, if you have 2-3 basements, you like to go with a mass excavations. You know, the excavation when you go for 4 basements and all, even if it is 1 basement, if it is 12 feet, 12 into 4 sides, almost 50 feet from your ground level, you will be going with the deep excavations. And coming, if you encounter in excavation, rock excavations, when you start the excavation, you will encounter with the soil also and also with the rock.
Wow, what are you doing with the rock excavation, like rock drilling, rock pressurized chiseling using pneumatic breakers, rock blasting like dynamite and controlled chemical blasting? Where you have to, say for example, if your site is near to an hospital, they will not allow you to use the dynamite, which will have create vibrations and which will also get you the cracks in the adjacent building, which in that time, in that areas, will have to use chemical blastings, which will be a controlled one. And when you complete your excavation, whether it is a soil excavation or a rock excavation, the next activity is individual footing with a PCC. I think what is meant by PCC?
Precast.
It's a fine cement concrete. And followed when you complete your fine cement concrete, the next item in a high-rise building or a low-rise building is the footing concrete with a rack foundation. You can have an individual footings and columns also with a rack foundation, where you can take out many columns out of the rack foundation. Rack foundation means, say for example, this is a hall, there are some 30-40 columns. Instead of having individual footing, you can have a direct rack slab, from where you can take the columns out of that rack slab. And after you come out with your footing concrete with the rack, when it is ready for the slab to cast, you will have to do the slab shattering followed by roof concreting. So the next sequencing is, as I already mentioned, the deep excavation will have 4 basements, 5 basements. You can have, I think two years back I went to Burj Khalifa, the tallest tower in the world. It's 128 floors and it's a height of 828 feet. It's almost to the vertical height of 1 kilometer. So then you imagine, whatever that 1 kilometer height you go, that will be for all the parking of that vehicles. You'll have to go some 10-15 basements. So anything below the ground is called the substructure. Anything above the ground level is called the superstructure. And okay, when you dig out, so I'm just quoting from the fourth basement, you will have to complete fourth basement, third basement, second basement, first basement, then you come to the ground level. When you come to the ground level, you will have to construct in a residential building or a commercial building. You want to have water sumps, pump rooms, fire water tanks, STP. What is STP? Sewage treatment plants. And there will be DG rooms, transformer yards. These are all the basic amenities for a residential building or a commercial building. And when you come to the ground floor, okay, then after ground floor, the superstructure start, as I already mentioned. You will start with ground floor, first floor, second floor, third floor, followed by, if I have a 20 floors, you will have to, you keep sequencing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 until the 20th floor. And after all you complete your 20th floor, you can see it's a bottom-up construction. Normally you will have a top-down construction also. And what I'm just explaining you is the bottom-up construction. And that's after you cast everything, it will be followed by block works. If it is a shear wall, I will also show that what is a shear wall. I have already said it's just an aluminium. You don't have a block wall. Everything will be a concrete. It will be cast in situ. It's called a shear wall. Shear wall, they say. If you cast out of the side, that will become a precast wall or a precast slab, precast staircase, precast beam. I'll show you on the slides. Everything is precast there. So when you complete your block work, you'll have to start with electrical works, plumbing works, and followed by lifts, door frames, window frames, fixing. And after all your electrical conduit, your plumbing, your waterproofing, everything is complete, the next activity will be the plastering. It is whether it might be internal plastering or external plastering with the different types of scaffolding. If you have a 20th floor, you'll have to have a MS top scaffoldings. And normally you don't prefer for a high-rise building, don't go with this casuarina poles scaffolding, which will have a tendency to slenderness ratio. If the length is more, it will have a tendency to buckle. So don't go for a high-rise building with a wooden scaffolding.
So when you, after the scaffolding, then you can do the plastic. Plastic will be normally done top down. You cannot do a plastic bottom up. If you have a 20 floor, you'll have to, when all the block work is completed, the plastic starts from 20th floor, 19th, the sequencing up to the ground floor. So if it is a sheer wall, as I said, already said, no need to plaster that. You can apply direct putty on that, you can finish, because it is a concrete wall. So I just explained what is the substructure and the superstructure. See, anything that the central line is the ground floor, anything below comes is the substructure. I've taken fourth basement, third basement, second basement, first basement, ground, first, second, third floor, until how many number of floors as you can construct. So whatever above the ground level is called what?
Superstructure.
Superstructure. Anything below the ground level is called?
Substructure.
So after you, when you complete the plastering, you'll have to do, if it is inside the toilets, you'll have to go with the waterproofing. And when you complete the waterproofing, you'll have to go with the tiling in the, inside the toilet areas. And on the terrace, you require a terrace waterproofing. Landscape works. If it is a high-rise residential building, you can create a wonderful garden there. And painting works. When you complete everything, you'll have to paint that. If there is internal paint and external paint. External paint, you will have exterior paints. Internal paints, you can have an acrylic emulsion, distemper. And followed by, when you complete your painting works, your electrical work fixtures like switches. And when you complete your toilet, you will have to fix with the CP and sanitary wares. What is CP called? It's a chromium plated. The taps and all, which will be a steel one, you know, that is a chromium plated. Why they do chromium plated is to avoid rust, corrosion. And when your toilet is ready with your CP and sanitary wares, you'll have to fix the door shutters, ironmongeries. Ironmongeries is a hardware where you'll have the all drop, tower bolts, hinges. And when you fix all the door, you'll have to charge with electric line and plumbing line. You have to, whatever the plumbing line and electric line, you will have to charge. Where you can have an, if it is a small building, you will be tapping from electrical pole. If it is a high-rise building, you will have to tap it from a transformer. Where the load will be more than 10,000 kVA, kilovolt ampere. It's a Bescom rules is more than 7,500 kVA, you will have to go for a substation. Then only they will allow you to draw the power from the substation. And when all this, everything is completed, that building will be ready for handing over to the buyers. And see, olden days, used to, the only manpower was involved. Nowadays, for a high-rise building, what are all the machineries used? I think you have, many people have seen the tower cranes.
Yes.
Tower crane is a vertical height where you can up to have 100 feet. Where it will have a 360 degree turn of more than 50 meter radius. And to take the material to the vertical floors, for example, if you have a 10th floor or to 20th floor, you cannot carry with the manpower. You will have to use building material hoist. And if it is a rock excavation, you will have to use pneumatic breakers. Excavators like, I think, JCB. This JCB, higher capacity, is called poke line. I have also mentioned JCB. To take out your soil or a rock, you require a dump trucks or tippers. Excavator with hydraulic breakers, you encounter with the rock excavation.
Batching plates.
And as our Manjunath sir and our Ramesh sir will be speaking more on the concrete part. And if it is a very big plant, if a very, very big residential building of more than 1,000 units to 1,500 units, 2,000 units, you cannot take concrete from outside because of the traffic involved. And where you have to just go for castings into, I mean, batching plant, inside batching plant. I'll be showing on the slides on that also. So we will just move to the normal low-rise buildings and waterproofing for toilets. Say, this is just a normal construction where the plinth beam level I'm showing you. You can see there, right? This is the plinth beam. And this is a slab with a sheet centering, where you can see the tension rod, the compression rods. This is a tension rod and this is a compression rod. This one is compression rod. Say this is normally considered as a low-rise building. A low-rise and a high-rise, the differentiation is, if your building is vertical taller than 15 meters, it is considered as a high-rise building. Say for example, if your one floor-to-floor height will be 3 meter, 3-5 size, 15 meters. So more than 50 feet, if your building is taller than 15 meter or 50 feet, it is considered as a high-rise building. These are all the column and the brickwork constructions, and these are all normal residential buildings. And you can see the column beam brickwork constructions there. Please just go through, because I want you to understand what is a minor shear wall, what is a column beam brickwork construction, and what is a precast construction. This is just a low-rise building. You can have a column, beam, slab, and solid blockwork constructions. See, this is just, it is a still, it is, you can see this is one of the, anything below the ground is called basement.
Basement.
So you can still consider this as a low rise only. So this is, it is ready for the plastering. As I already said, for a low rise you can use wooden scaffolding for the plastering. And for the plaster mesh, you can see this is the plaster mesh. The balcony, normally earlier used to use chicken mesh. Now they will use an angle, L-angle with a welded mesh where you can plaster that. These are all low-rise buildings where the building is ready for the plastering. You can see here the M-SAN. This one. What is M-SAN?
Manufacturing, sir.
Pardon me? Manufacturing sand. Because why you are using manufacturing sand? Because government has banned using the river sand.
Yes, sir.
Why? Because the water getting depleted below the ground level, the water table, you don't, it is going more than 2000 feet where you don't get a water there. These are all a low rise building. And this is the finished van where your building is ready for the plastic. This was the I monitored this as a central one. This is some interiors. You can see these are all low-rise buildings. This is one of the side elevation of the building. You can see this is one of my friends' architect building where he has created landscape on the terrace. You can see this the building with the so many features, architectural features. And this is a solar. Nowadays for a high-rise residential building, you have to back up your landscape light with a solar power. And this is sustainability they call. It is called the SOL, where sustainable, O for optimization, U for utilization, L for livable. You have to take care of the environment, because nowadays we are spoiling the environment like anything. Okay, this is the some projected cantilever patterns. You can see, these are all cantilever patterns. And the toilet, I'll just highlight what is the plumbing works inside the toilet. See, this is, after plastering, you'll have to go with your PVC pipe, UPVC pipes. Earlier, you used to have this GI pipes. What is GI?
Galvanized iron.
Why you are, nowadays we are avoiding galvanized iron? Because of the corrosion. And I'm just showing, this is the water, when your toilet is a mother slab they call. You can see this is the waterproof below this one. And your waterproofing is folded 1 feet above. And these are the for the EWC and for the general drain out area. And this is the wash basin point. And these are the few photos of the plumbing as well as waterproofing. Okay, I'll come to the low-rise and low-rise beam wall construction buildings. As I said, if you have many, many columns, don't go for individual footings. You can go for a wrap foundation. A wrap foundation is, it is a mat of, you will have a 2-3 layers, a compression layer, a tension layer, where you will have that, you can jet out your columns from the wrap foundation. So you can see that, so many columns. I'll just come to the high-rise building. What I just explained was on the low-rise building. The low-rise is a building which is lesser than
15
feet or 15 meters. Where you can high-rise building, where it will consist of a column being blocked or a podium. A podium is the one, a ground floor level where a vertical tower is 20 floors, the ground floor, whatever your projection is called a podium slab at the ground floor level. And where you can create landscape, you can create your swimming pool, you can create your indoor swimming pool, you can create your external swimming pool, outdoor swimming pool, heated swimming pool, you can create kids play area, wading pool, I showed all the photos of that. See, this is one of the high-rise building in Elita Promenade, which I was in construction in charge for, which took 8 years. It was having a number of units of 1,573 units. It had two phases. Phase 1 was 10 towers, and phase 2 was 7 towers, 943 and 643. Put together, it was 1,573 units. See, this is the tower crane, this one. And this is the podium slab. This is the baffle slab, they call. As I already mentioned, whatever jetting out on the grounded floor level is called
podium
slab. You have some fire escape staircases of the podium slabs. You know, in the event of if you are parking your car in the basement, suddenly there is a fire. There will be every 30 meters, there will be one escape. You can come out to the ground floor level to the assembly area. You know, one of the high-rise building fire hazard is a very biggest problem. You will have to definitely take care of that. I think the recently, some 3-4 last year, there was a tutorial where the students were jumping. You know, there was a fire in that, in one of the North India, where students were jumping during the event of the fire. See, as I said, this is the baffle slab. Baffle slab is used. This is inverted a kid's tub. You can see this is a small tub. When you invert that, why we use a baffle slab in a podium slab in the car parking, where you can park your car below that podium slab. If you go for 30 meter deep columns, the intermediate columns, you will have a slab of more than 850 mm to 1 meter. If you go with this baffle slab, your slab depth will be only 275 mm. So you will be saving a lot of concrete as well as your reinforcement also. You will have a mesh in that. You will have a nominal reinforcement with a mesh combined. When you concrete this, see, this is a concreted area, and this is ready for concrete. This is the tower crane. And I just said this is a plaza staircase, a fire escape staircase. This is the one where I said it's a G plus 19 floors with two basements. You can see the tower cranes here. These are the tower cranes. See, this is column beam block work with a plastic. See, this is the phase 2. The first photo is the phase 2, which is consists of 7 blocks. And this is the phase 1 of 10 blocks. This is when the building is complete. You can have a landscape over the podium. See, this you can have in the fire assembly area. This is the wading pool. This is over the podium slab. Below that, you can park your cars. This is the beautiful landscape. This is the external outdoor swimming pool. And I said, you can create your kids play area over the podium slab. This one.
This is the beautiful finished tower which was handled by me. This consists of 943 units. This is two basements, ground plus 19 floor building. I want all of my engineers one day to monitor such type of buildings, high-rise buildings. See, this was the phase one of 943 units, and this is the phase two of seven towers of 647 units. This one phase two. You have a fire tender path all over the building. Fire tender path is designed for 45 ton loading. In the event of the fire, a fire engine, you can call a fire engine which can travel all around the perimeter of the building. See this one? It travels. So that was a high-rise building with a column, beam, solid block work. And this is what about the next building, the high-rise building I'm showing is the sheer wall, where you don't have any block work in this. You should understand the difference. Entire wall will be of a solid concrete wall. And I'll show you the formwork of that. This is the aluminium formwork, where everything, the cage, your wall, everything will be nominal vertical reinforcement. When you pour the concrete and you can de-shutter after 4-5 days, your concrete wall will be ready. This is made out of Maiwan shuttering. It's a sheer wall concept where you don't have any block wall. You no need to plaster in the sheer wall. You can directly apply putty. Two coats, three coats, and you can directly apply the color whatever you want. This consists of 1.5 acre. It is a 128 units, and this is the fourth or fifth tallest tower in Bangalore. This is of 33 floors. It's a Maya in Viprastha, and it consists of 33 floors. It's almost 128 units. One floor consists of 4 units. 1 acre is how many square feet, my dear students? 43,560 square feet is 1 acre of land. 1 acre of land is how many guntas?
40
guntas. 1 gunta is how many square feet? 1089 square feet is called 1 gunta. That 1 gunta, 1089, how can it come?
33.
Who is that? Who explained that? Okay, a big round of applause to her. Is it audible? This is another side of the elevation of this 33 floors of 20 units in 1.5 acres. The tallest tower in Bangalore of 33 floors. The second tallest tower is in Mantri Pinnacle in Bellangatta Road, where it is 42 floors. And one of the tallest tower in southern India is coming. It's the Presidential Tower. That is 50 floors, ground plus 50 floors. It's already started the construction. So, I come to my favorite topic subject, the precast technology. So in the precast technology, I said, you will encounter excavation, you will have a batching plant, you have a cover frame, you will have the safety features. There was a rock excavation. This area was of 20 acres. There was a full of rock of 16 acres. I'll show you the slides. And there was a diamond rock cutting, compressors, pipeline, rock breakers. And as I said, when you come to the ground level, you require water sumps, you will have to podium, whatever the horizontal spread of the vertical tower is a podium slab. And you have to waterproof the retaining wall. And sewage treatment plant, I will be showing some slides on that. and I showed the precast factory and on-site precast wall as well as slab installation, and on the site I showed you the slides. See, this is the rock excavation where you can see the rock breakers, hydraulic rock breakers. You can see that it's called a JCB higher version, it's called coke line, where you will be fitted with the rock breakers. When you go to the, if you have to visit one of the construction site, you will be hearing it sound tap 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 tap. It will be so horrible, horrible it is. You will be having more than 10 to 20 such type of breaking the rocks into pieces. So you can see that this is the breaker, rock breaker. You can see there are the two coke lines with the rock breakers. See there, the poke lines with the rock breakers. There was a massive rock, everywhere there was a rock. So we blasted more than 10 meters of rock on the 16 acres of land. So you can see that, all the rock excavations. See, I said that the 33 floor Maya and the Costa besides for the project. And this is the compressors, rock breaking with the compressors. See, you can see there are the rubbles of rock where the massive rock has been broken into pieces. You can see a double crane. This is a double crane. So you can see the massive rocks there. Diamond rock cutting, where a diamond element, where you can encircle the entire rock, that will break into a cake like rock. You can break into pieces. You can see that. Can you see that one man is operating this? See, this is called diamond rock cutting. See, you can see the vertical slit of the rock. And the power is by